Hey, good morning, everyone. Good to see all of you here today. As Michael mentioned, Amy and I get the privilege of sharing God's word with you all together as a couple this morning. I couldn't go into this text without bringing her up here with me. So glad to have you up here with us today. And all of you here in the room and all of you watching online, as Michael mentioned as well, this Living Masterpiece series, we're in part six next week as we have Baptism Sunday in both of our campuses. We'll be ending this series on Ephesians. And my prayer has been that as we launched a brand new theme for our year as a church back in September, deeply rooted. We define deeply rooted as grounded, growing, and grateful. Grounded in God, grounded in the Word of God, growing in Christ and in His character and His nature. And grateful, gratitude, being people who overflow with thanksgiving and thankfulness. And so that's our theme for this year. The first series of that theme has been Living Masterpieces. And that comes, for those of you who are brand new today or you've been away for a little while, let me just remind you, that comes from a phrase that the Apostle Paul uses in this letter. So this letter to the Ephesians was written by one of the first generation followers of Jesus. His name was Paul. Jesus had transformed his life. And he was a scholar. He was a Pharisee, a religious leader. And Jesus got a hold of him and changed the trajectory of his life. And so he actually pastored this church in Ephesus. And we've been telling you this the last several weeks, but let me remind you again, or if you're brand new, this is a church that's meeting in the Roman Empire in the colony of Ephesus, and it's made up of two major people groups, the Jewish people who had believed that Jesus actually was their Messiah, and they'd begun to follow him, and then you had Romans, you had Greeks, you had Gentiles who were also believing in this Jewish Messiah, and they were putting their faith in leaving their pagan religions to put their faith and their trust in Jesus. And so these people gathered together, and this letter was written from a Roman prison. The Apostle Paul is actually in a Roman prison when he writes this letter to these people that he had actually pastored for a little bit between 3 and 3.5 years or so. And so now he has a heart for these people, and he wants them to know that they are the handiwork of God. They are the craftsmanship of their Creator, Almighty God. And so what we've been sharing over these last several weeks has been that as followers of Jesus, we are to be living masterpieces. We are living masterpieces. We bear the image of our Creator, which influences and impacts everything that we do and how we live and how we interact with, because it's not just followers of Jesus that are made in the image of God. Everyone is made in the image of God. And so that has huge implications for how we live and how we follow Jesus in this messy, difficult world. But the reality is, it's no more difficult than it was in the first century, as Paul writes. And so, we have come to chapter 5. So if you have your Bibles or you get those digital notes that he mentioned inside the app, we're going to be in chapter 5. But before we read the text, there's three main blocks of text that we're going to look at here together today that we believed are inspired and anointed by the Holy Spirit for us today. But before we do those, we need to put them in context, because every text that you read comes inside of a larger context. And that's a huge, huge key to understanding these texts that we're going to be looking at here together today. So what I did was, in your digital notes, I put kind of a review, a very high-level review of where we've been, because what we'll often do when we get to these various texts is we'll pull them right out of their context. But you need to see the stream of thought and the stream of consciousness that the Apostle Paul has had as we get to this place. And so as we have been over these last several weeks, we've been looking at the idea that living masterpieces, as living masterpieces, we are loved, chosen, and adopted by God. In Christ, we have been freed, forgiven. We are both an inheritance, and we receive an inheritance from God. In the Holy Spirit, we are signed, sealed, and delivered. The wall of hostility has been torn down between us and others. And for them specifically, it was this wall of hostility between Jews and Gentiles. For us, it's the wall of hostility that would keep us from being in healthy, God-honoring relationships in our world today and with people who see differently than we do. And that wall of hostility for us as Christians has been torn down because we are in Christ. This happens through Christ. and because we are with Christ, and Paul lays all of that out. Then we talked about this, the idea that as living masterpieces, we are to live the life that Christ has called us to. He never calls us down. He always calls us up, because dead for us is done. We went into the next chapter and we talked about, as living masterpieces, we're going to be teachable, united, and mature. And then last week, we talked about this idea that we are living for what is proper and wise. We are to reflect the Maker. And we do all of this with a very high worth and a high value on others. And so all that we just talked about in the last 45 seconds frames where we're headed today, because Paul says, as we go into all of these next several texts, we need to keep all of this stuff in mind, because it then changes and gives us a greater, broader, more deep understanding of these next few things that he's going to tell us. Because he's going to address men and women. He's going to address marriage, he's going to address children and parenting and families, and he's going to address both people who owned others as well as people who were owned. Now, we'll get to that in just a moment, but all of that frames this next section, that in a patriarchal, if you don't know this about the first century, it was a very patriarchal, male-dominated, violent society. Might makes right was how things were in the first century. And so the Holy Spirit inspired and empowered some game-changing, culture-transforming, groundbreaking types of things in this next section that changes history as we know it. And it begins in these first century churches, where these men and women, Jews and Gentiles, insiders and outsiders, come together to then infiltrate, permeate, and make the Roman Empire completely change over the next several hundred years. So, with that in mind, we want to ask a big question here together today as we go into these next few verses. And the question is simply this. We'll put it up on the screen. It's there in your notes. There's a phrase that Paul uses today, and this is the question that we want to wrestle with. How does reverence for Christ impact our relationships? Paul's going to say, because we're living masterpieces, and because we see one another completely different as a result of the reality that we're made in the image of God, we live as living masterpieces out of reverence for Christ. And so how does that reverence for Christ impact all of these things that he's about to talk about? And I'll give you the sneak peek in case you're watching online and you've got to go somewhere else in just a moment. Those of you that are here, you're not leaving. We have cameras. No, I'm just kidding. I'll give you the heads up right now. Here's how reverence for Christ impacts our relationships. We live with a culture and an attitude and a perspective and a commitment to honor. And I've taught you this over the years in the past. We often will get confused with honor and respect. We'll confuse those two things. And honor in the scriptures is given. Respect is earned. And so we're going to talk in this next several moments together as Amy and I unpack these and we pray together. We're going to unpack what it looks like to live with a reverence for Christ. And it really begins with honor, and that begins with where we were last week in chapter 5 as we talked about being filled with the Holy Spirit. And the filling and the empowerment changes everything. And if you're investigating Jesus, if you would say, I'm not yet a follower, if you're exploring faith, we're glad that you're here and we want to encourage you to keep coming. And the things that we talk about here today, these are challenging things for people who are followers of Jesus, who are filled with the Holy Spirit. But the Spirit of God enables us and equips us to be able to live this way one day at a time. And so if you could begin to see the life transformation that Jesus brings and how that impacts your relationships, we believe that following Jesus and committing our lives to him actually makes life better and our relationships healthier. It's not easy, but that's the calling. That's the ability that God gives us through his Holy Spirit because of what Jesus did at the cross and in the resurrection. So, you're going to notice, as Amy reads this first text, that there are a few, these next several texts actually, that there are a few quotation marks. You'll see some quotes throughout, and you need to keep in mind that the Apostle Paul, as I mentioned, he was a Jewish man who often references the Hebrew Scriptures. So though we're in the New Testament today, his Bible, the Bible of the first century, was the 39 books of the Hebrew Scriptures. We know it today as the Old Testament. So he's going to quote several texts, one from Genesis, one from Exodus, and one from Deuteronomy. And keeping in mind that the audience then, they would have seen those hyperlinks that sometimes we with our Western Christianity miss, but it was very clear what was being quoted here. And the Jewish people in the room, as they're reading this parchment, as they're reading this letter from Paul, they would have been helping their Gentile friends to go, oh yeah, hey, that's what this is. That's what this is. That's what he's referring back to there. So keeping that in mind, with all of that being said, how does reverence for Christ impact our relationships? We're going to begin in Ephesians chapter 5 and verse 21. Let me pray. Spirit of a living God, we offer this to you today. We ask you to help us here in this room and all watching online right now to hear from you, to be receptive to what you want to speak to us. Challenge us, convict us, inspire us, encourage us, heal us, reconcile us. We open ourselves to you. Give us minds and ears and hearts that are open so that we might be not only hearers of your word, but that we might apply it. We might be doers of it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. For wives, this means submit to your husbands as to the Lord. For a husband is the head of the wife, as Christ is the head of the church. He is the Savior of his body, the church. As the church submits to Christ, so you wives should submit to your husbands in everything. For husbands, this means love your wives, just as Christ loved the church. He gave up his life for her to make her holy and clean, washed by the cleansing of God's word. He did this to present her to himself as a glorious church, without a spot or wrinkle or any other blemish. Instead, she will be holy and without fault. In the same way, husbands ought to love their wives as they love their own bodies. For a man who loves his wife actually shows love to himself. No one hates his own body, but feeds it, cares for it, just as Christ cares for the church. And we are members of his body. As the scriptures say, a man leaves his father and mother and is joined to his wife, and the two are united into one. This is a great mystery, but it is an illustration of the way Christ and the church are one. So again, I say, each man must love his wife as he loves himself, and the wife must respect her husband.
So the big thought here, as we think about how does reverence for Christ impact our relationships, it begins, Paul says, when we honor the living masterpiece that is our husband and our wife. When we talk about honor, I want to be very clear. Honor, the definition is to value, to highly esteem, to treat as precious, weighty, or valuable. On the flip side, a lack of honor is dishonor. It's to treat as common or to treat as ordinary. And when we talk about this idea of reverence for Christ, what that really means is that we're placing ourselves under the authority of King Jesus. And out of that reverence for Christ, out of submitting to his authority, we submit to one another. Out of deference for Christ. Our natural tendency, Paul writes to the Philippians, is that we want to pursue selfish ambition and vain conceit. But the Holy Spirit helps us, out of deference for Christ, to submit to one another. Reverence for Christ means that we have a profound respect, love, gratitude, and obedience to Jesus. And then that spills out over upon our spouse. We are to see them. We are to speak to them and about them and to treat them as Jesus would. We are to actually, out of an overflow of gratitude, thank God every day for the person that is our spouse. I want to challenge you to esteem your spouse as a priceless work of art, handcrafted by your Creator, which means that we love unconditionally, and out of that love, we serve our spouse. That means that we unconditionally accept our spouse. Don't confuse that with approve of everything. But we unconditionally accept our spouse, which then allows us to forgive them as the Lord has forgiven us. We speak truth, and we do that in love, and that helps to foster and develop trust in our relationship. We keep the value high, and therefore we honor the living masterpiece that is our spouse. The reality is that in life, everything around us, everything that we own, every material thing that we have, tends to devalue over the course of time. And unless we are incredibly intentional, we will devalue our spouse. We will devalue our kids. We will devalue the people that are around us in our lives. And so we have to work hard to keep the value high, because what we value, we honor. Mutual submission. When Paul talks about we are to submit to one another out of reverence for Christ, that is a sacrificial love that lays down our lives for one another. Notice that Paul talks about provision. We feed and we care for. We take care of one another. And I want to invite you to think about, when was the last time I prayed for my spouse? Not prayed that God would fix him or fix her. I know, we do it. Amy prays, you pray that? Oh, no. We pray for them, that actually ends up changing us. And marriage between one man and one woman is a beautiful blessing. It pictures, as Paul describes here, and it's woven throughout the fabric of many of the New Testament documents, the profound mystery of Christ and the church. All the way back from Genesis, all the way through the book of Revelation, there's this theme that runs through, and marriage is actually the depiction of what we will be in all of eternity as the bride of the Lord Jesus Christ. He's the groom, and we are the bride. And the reality is that marriage should not be idolized. Marriage is a beautiful gift, but it should not be idolized. In its proper context, yes, it's a gift from the Lord. But those who are single, those who are widowed, are not less than or incomplete. A spouse doesn't complete us. They can complement us, but they do not complete us, and they don't make us more valuable. Jesus completes us. And only King Jesus. If you're looking to someone else, whether that's a spouse or a kid or a parent or someone that you're working alongside or a friend, if you're looking for anyone other than Jesus to complete you, no one can carry that weight. No one was designed to carry that weight. Only Jesus completes us. And never forget this. Sometimes I think we forget this. Our Savior was single for the whole of his life. And Paul was eventually single as well. We don't know for sure if he was ever married. I tend to think that he probably was, but the scriptures never say that. And the reason I think that is because he was a Pharisee, and one of the qualifications, the requirements of a Pharisee, was that you had to be married. So whether that was suspended for him or not, we don't know, but at some point along the way, for sure, we know that he was single. So thinking about that, as you came into this place today and you're watching online, what does our Lord think about us, whether we are single or married? And the good news, as Paul describes here, the gospel, what does God think about you? Jesus laid down his life for you, for me, to make you, as he says there, holy and clean, washed, glorious, and faultless. Don't miss this. You, whether you are married or single, you have infinite worth and you have infinite value to God in heaven. And you do to us too. And we're so honored to be able to share this with you. We hope that this is encouraging to you because you were made in his image. And so right now, I want to ask Amy to pray. Pray for specifically, because this is the focus of our text today, pray specifically for those of us in the room who are married. and maybe your spouse isn't here right now or isn't sitting next to you right now. Maybe you want to pull up a photo or just get them right in your mind. If you want to take the hand of the person next to you and pray, maybe you're here with another couple and you want to pray with them, however you want to do this, let's go to God and let's talk to Him about how we can, out of reverence for Christ, honor the living masterpiece that is our spouse.
Heavenly Father, this is the ideal that you've set before us here in Ephesians. In Psalms, it says, let us exalt His name together. This is what we're to do. This is our goal. But the struggle is real. The attractions of first day or love, it grows cold. Communication gets difficult and minimal. Spots of carelessness, wrinkles of neglect, and blemishes of intentional jabs abound. But you do not call us to something that is impossible for us to accomplish. Throughout the Old Testament and the New, you say over and over again that nothing is impossible for you. You are able to teach us to be married. I can stand as a testimony to that. You can teach us, you can show us how to do this thing and to do it well. And Lord, we can not worry about our own needs. We can lay those down because we know with you our needs will always be met. So Father, would you come? Would you help us? Teach us your ways and help us to put them into practice. Help us to want to do the hard work.
Yes, Lord.
Help us to want to do what is pleasing to you. Give us wisdom to know what to do and when to do it, what to say, what not to say, and timing. Would you give hope to those who are feeling hopeless?
Yes, Holy Spirit.
And Lord, we're asking these things so that we can be an example to the world that marriage is a blessing, it is a joy, and it can be done well. Lord, help us today to start loving you most, putting you first,
yes,
and loving our spouse well. We ask these things in your name, Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Paul continues, and now he shifts his attention to families, to the relationship that we have with our children and our parents, and no matter how old we get, we're always still somebody's kid. So let's pay attention as we begin chapter 6, the first four verses here.
Children, obey your parents because you belong to the Lord, for this is the right thing to do. Honor your father and mother. This is the first commandment with a promise. If you honor your father and mother, things will go well for you, and you will have a long life on the earth. Fathers, do not provoke your children to anger by the way you treat them. Rather, bring them up with the discipline and instruction that comes from the Lord.
How do we do this reverence for Christ thing in our homes with our kids and our parents? We honor the living masterpiece that is our child, that is our parent. Notice that Paul says there in those verses, you belong to Jesus. Therefore, put your worship, put your reverence and your devotion to Christ on display. And not because they are perfect, not because your parents are perfect, not because they are worthy or because they are consistent or even that they are always fair. We do this out of reverence for Christ. And so, with the help of the Holy Spirit, we want to see our kids. We want to see our parents as Jesus sees them. We want to speak to them and we want to speak about them as Jesus would speak to and about them. And we want to treat them as Jesus would. And we want to thank the Lord for our parents, for our kids every day. For all of us that are kids, no matter how old we are, honor in a culture of dishonor and disrespect begins as we obey. As we obey. And there are promises that come with this. Paul quotes the Hebrew scriptures here, and the promises that God gave, if we would honor our parents, is that it would go well with us and that we would live a long life. All of that is relative. That does not mean that it's going to be easy, that there will never be trials or tribulations or difficulties or tension or disappointment. But we can see a difference in our families if we will embed a culture of honor and remember that our parents and our children are living masterpieces. So for kids, what do we do here? How can we honor? A very simple thing is to tell our parents what's going on in our lives, to share with them our burdens, our concerns, our fears, our stresses, our joys. They actually, as a parent, I can tell you, and as talking with my father, he wants to hear that, even though I'm 50 years old and he's not parenting me day to day in the same way. He wants to hear those things. It's a way to honor your parents, to share with them what's going on in your life, to pray for your parents and ask yourself, how would Jesus treat your mom? How would Jesus treat your dad? How would Jesus treat your step-parent? We need help with this. We need wisdom. And parents, live in a way that makes it easy for your kids to honor you. Don't abuse these commands. Don't use them to leverage up and power up. Remember, out of reverence for Christ, we submit to, we come under the authority of Jesus, and we submit ourselves with the help of the Holy Spirit, one to another. So we don't abuse these commands. We love and we cherish our children. We bring them up with a consistent and predictable, as Paul says, discipline and instruction. And he quotes again, he gives this reference back to the book of Deuteronomy, and embedded in those Hebrew scriptures are the framework, are the game plan for how to do this. When we get up in the morning, when we lie down at night, during meals, when we're traveling, we invite our kids into the conversation to help foster and develop a childlike faith. We do not hinder them, we bless them, and I want to encourage you and challenge you, as parents and as grandparents, as aunts and uncles, with whatever influence that you have, to partner with Riverside Kids and Nexus Student Ministry to raise up a generation that loves and serves God, Sundays and Wednesdays, and prioritize relationship with Jesus and a love for the Word of God over rites and rituals and religion. And one of the best ways that you can do this is to show them, you know, we feel this tension, we feel this pressure as parents to raise godly kids. But the reality is, in the most perfect of environments, in the Garden of Eden with a perfect parent, we still chose sin. We still chose, Adam and Eve still chose rebellion. And we cannot guarantee that as parents, but what we can do is we can model for them what godly parenting looks like, what a godly parent is. And so I would submit to you that our kids need to see right out of the gate from a very early age the prioritization of our relationship with our Heavenly Father. Our relationship, if you're married, with your spouse. Our kids, quite frankly, need to know that they're third on the list. They'll be okay, and they'll thank you for it when they grow up. Our tendency, once we have children, is to become child-centric, and our kids are the most important thing. But guess what? They'll leave someday. And then you're going to have this spouse that if you haven't prioritized them over your kids, you're going to be strangers. And so we're pleading with you today to honor the living masterpiece that is your spouse and that is your child, that is your parent. And for them to see you honor King Jesus, honor your spouse, and then say, hey, you're next. Above my job, above my hobbies, above other things, you come before all of those things. But we don't do our kids any favors when they think that they are the center of the world. Could I get an amen there, maybe? You guys are out there, right? So how would Jesus treat your kids? Pray for your children. Pray for them to have hearts that are turned to the Lord. Some of us are praying for our kids to have hearts that would return to the Lord. bless them, encourage them, and prioritize them, as I said, based on the truths of Scripture. And we're not making this stuff up. The Scriptures are clear. The truths are God first, spouse next, kids third. Let's pray for our families.
Jesus, you yourself lived in a very messy situation. Your earthly father was not your actual father. I'm sure there were rumors and mumblings about your mother and how you came about. Your half-siblings didn't respect you. Your family called you crazy. Yet you honored them. With the help of the Holy Spirit, we can honor our families as well. As Jesus followers, we don't have to do it like the world does it. We don't have to fight and slam doors. We know there's a different way, a better way, with the help of the Holy Spirit. Would you compel us, our families, to put you first on the schedule? As individuals, put you first on our schedule daily, and to put you first on the schedule of the family calendar.
Yes.
Would you spark conversation about you as we're going about our day? Give us courage to put you first and be different in a world that is changing so quickly.
Yes.
Help us to call out to you when we need help, when we've come up against a wall and we don't know what to do. Help us to call out to you and to expect you to answer, to expect you to show us what to do. Give us creativity in our parenting to know what to do next, what next step to take. And as children, respecting our parents, would you give us the words, the actions, and the timing? We ask these things in your name, Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Before Amy reads this final section, I want to remind you of the realities of the Roman Empire in the first century. As we've talked about many times before, no one should own another person. It's inhumane, it's unthinkable, it's detestable, and certainly it is intolerable in 2022. And the reason for this is because of Jesus and the way that he and his followers began to teach and began to live as if everyone was made in the image of Yahweh and that we all have inherent worth and value. And so when Paul writes this letter, the movement of Jesus is less than 30 years old. And Paul is consistently and he is systematically planting the seeds that over the next two millennia will result ultimately in what we know today as the equality of all humanity and the abolishment of slavery. So he's working within the system as he writes to followers of Jesus. And in the first century, the Roman Empire had home codes, household codes, and how people were to operate within their homes. And so he's using those here. It's very, very familiar language to the first century folks as he's talking about homes and marriages and parenting and kids. And now he begins to shift this perspective to slaves and to slave owners. And for us today, this translates into our workplace environments because we don't have that any longer. He's going to eventually tell us here how in our language today, in our thoughts, how employers and employees should get along, how they should treat one another, and a heads up, out of reverence for Christ, whether we're the boss, whether we're their employer, or we're employed by someone else, we are to serve one another. Ephesians 5, we'll pick it up, or 6, we'll pick it up in verse 5.
Slaves, obey your earthly masters with deep respect and fear. Serve them with sincerity, as you would serve Christ. Try to please them all the time, not just when they're watching you. As slaves of Christ, do the will of God with all your heart. Work with enthusiasm, as though you are working for the Lord rather than for people. Remember that the Lord will reward each one of the Lord will reward each one of us for the good we do, whether we are slaves or free. Masters, treat your slaves in the same way. Don't threaten them. Remember, you both have the same master in heaven, and he has no favorites.
So here Paul says for us today, honor the living masterpiece that is your colleague. Honor the living masterpiece that is your colleague. He mentions serve them sincerely. He tells those that are working for their masters, for their employers, to serve sincerely. But then later, he says, treat your people the same, treat your slaves in the same way. Sincere service is the standard for followers of Jesus, which means that when we are serving others, we bring our excellence, we bring our effort. We show up on time. We don't waste the time of others. We foster in our workplaces a culture of trust rather than suspicion. We don't overpromise and then underdeliver. We, as followers of Jesus who are in our workplaces, working for those that employ us, we, when we have a moment where we've said we're going to do this, and it actually ended up being this, we don't want to surprise those that we work alongside or those that we work for, so we go and we talk about it. We address the gap. Hey, I said I was going to do this, or I said I was going to go over here. This was going to be the result of this project or this conversation. It ended up being this. I'm going to address the gap. We lead the way in letting our actions match our words. As followers of Jesus, who as living masterpieces and working for living masterpieces, we bring our passions to our job. We free our teammates from lethargic, apathetic, and half-hearted effort. And for those of us who lead, for those of us who are managers or employers or owners perhaps, I want to speak to you. I want to challenge you as the Holy Spirit's been challenging me to lead with predictability, to lead with consistency. No one enjoys working for or alongside someone who is unpredictable. Lead with humility rather than dominance. No one wants to work for or work alongside a bully. Let's be honest. Let's be vulnerable. Let's be transparent. And as leaders, let's be great communicators. Discard passivity and engage those you work alongside. Don't, as the leader, don't be lazy and don't be the weak link. Our places of work need healthy, equipping, and empowering leaders. And for all of us, whether we're the employer or we're the employee, we need to be dependable. We need to finish our work on time and be a joy to work with. Remember, as Paul says here, and he says it in some of the other New Testament letters, ultimately we don't work for the person that employs us. We work for King Jesus. And out of reverence for Christ, may the Holy Spirit help us to see our colleagues and to speak to them and about them and to treat them as Jesus would. How would Jesus treat your colleagues? Thank God for your job, even if it's not a job that you're enjoying right now, out of an overflow of gratitude and thankfulness. We thank him for the people that we work alongside. But you don't know the workplace that I'm in. You're right, I don't. And they may not act respectable. That's why we give honor. And they may not be always above board. And that's a deep, difficult conversation to have as a follower of Jesus. But out of reverence for Christ, we do the things that we know are godly. And we want to pray for our workplaces.
Heavenly Father, you created us to work. From the very beginning, you gave us the blessing of work. It was not a curse, it was a blessing. So Father, for those that need jobs, would you order their steps and help them to find the job that is for them, that's gonna be a blessing to them and to their family. For those that need a transition, would you give them wisdom to know what to do? For those who are retiring, would you give them grace to transition? And to know that there is more purpose after life, after work, there is more purpose for them. For those who are struggling in their workplaces, would you give them courage? You do not turn your head away from us as we walk into our workplaces. You are Emmanuel, God with us. That's not just a Christmas term, a Christmas word. That is our everyday reality as followers of Jesus. You are with us, and you are in us. so we can go into these hostile work environments and be a non-anxious presence.
Thank you.
We can be the peace and the joy. We can stand our ground, not tossed about by the wicked talk around us. Give us strength and remind us we are salt and light. We hold the answer to the depravity around us. And that answer is you, King Jesus. Give us courage and compel us to look to you every day before entering our work environments. Help us to say the prayer, ask for help, and to remember we don't walk through those doors alone.
Thank you.
You are with us, and we thank you for that. In your name we pray, Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Put simply today, deeply rooted followers of Jesus foster a culture, no matter where we are, in our homes or in our workplaces, on our campuses, in our classrooms, of honor and reverence by how we see others, how we speak to and about them, and how we treat them. And today, focused attention has been given to pursuing couples, families, and workplaces that are deeply rooted. But the reality is that it's not just there. Paul has other places that he talks about this. So you might be seated there today and you're so thankful that Paul didn't mention or that we haven't talked about this or that or the other. So we're going to wrap it up with this question. Who would Jesus ask you to honor out of reverence for him? Maybe it's a sibling. It's your brother or your sister or your stepbrother, your step-parent. Maybe it's your in-laws. Mine are watching right now. I honor you, Bill and Connie. Maybe it's a coach or the faculty, the administration. Maybe it's a friend that he's asking you to honor, a pastor, a government official, a first responder. Could you even honor the police officer that pulls you over when you were breaking the law? Oh, you've crossed a line there. Could we honor the person that cuts us off in traffic? Could we honor the individual that's serving us in the restaurant or whatever store we're shopping? Yes. Yes, we can. In fact, the Apostle Paul calls us to this when he writes to the church in Rome, outdo one another in showing honor. Outdo one another in showing honor. Would you stand? And I want to pray one last time, and then we're going to have people in the back corners here that came today to pray with you and pray for you. You may want to come and find a place down here around the front and pray. We're going to sing together. But I want to pray for those that are hardest for us to honor as we wrap this up. Father, thank you for leaving these very challenging words that convict us, that stretch us, but that ultimately are for our good and for the good of this world. So out of reverence for you, King Jesus, would you help us to honor those that are toughest, that are most difficult, that even right now as I'm praying, you're reminding us of him, of her, of them, and you want us to grow. We can't do that without being grounded first in our identity in you. So shift our perspective when we struggle to see them, him, her, as a living masterpiece. Reframe that for us, I pray. And may we truly outdo one another in showing honor. May our homes, may our families, may our workplaces, and may our world one conversation at a time move from dishonor to honor. From irreverence to reverence. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, I pray this. Amen.